of Moses. It's the first five books that you would find in the Bible: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And so we believe that the foundation of Jewish faith comes from those five books. So they're the foundation, and then there are lots of other books and writings that stem from that, but that is the foundation, the first book and the base book that we read.
How old is that book of
the one? The one we carried around actually was written in 2007. So it's new, but we have one in our congregation that's about 180 years old. There are scrolls that are older than that. This one, the one that we carry, we have other ones in there that are older, but that specific one. So traditionally, a Torah scroll can only be written by a man. There are jobs in Judaism that only men can do, things that women can do. Traditionally, only a man. But in 2006, 2007, we commissioned a female scribe, and she was the first woman in modern history to scribe an entire Torah herself, and that was the one that we walked around. Some people, some people might say, nope, we can't use it. A woman wrote it. But in our congregation, we celebrate that a man or a woman could write the scroll. So
the four Torahs
they just are different sizes, and they come from different times, and they actually don't represent anything other than the fact that we happen to have four. Some congregations, you'll open up their ark, what's called an ark. They might have 10. They might only have one. Sometimes it depends on how old the congregation is. Sometimes it depends on, it can be a very young congregation, but it was meaningful for people, for families to say, we want to buy a Torah scroll and donate a Torah scroll, and so the congregation has very many of them. The really big one that we have in the back, it's the tallest one that's in there, that actually is a scroll that was saved from a congregation. We don't even actually know where it came from, other than it came from Czechoslovakia. During World War II, the Nazis burned down a lot of synagogues, and they gathered up all of the religious objects. And after the war, British soldiers found in basements just rooms filled with Torah scrolls and rooms filled with Jewish ritual objects. Some of these communities were completely wiped out, and only their scrolls were remaining, and they were tagged, they were marked that they came from this region. They might not have known the particular city, but they knew the region. And so what happened is that a British Jewish man came in, he purchased all of those ritual objects, he updated and cleaned up all of those scrolls that had just been tossed into these basement rooms, and then what he created was a foundation, and synagogues around the world were given the opportunity to bring a scroll to their synagogue, and it's on loan. It's part of a museum organization, and we get to keep it in our congregation, and it stands as a testament or a witness to what went on during World War II by the Nazis, but also for us, it helps us remember this community in Czechoslovakia that was wiped out, and their scroll is the only thing that remains. And so in St. Louis, many of our Jewish congregations all have, we call them a Holocaust scroll, have one of these scrolls, and once a year, we have a big community celebration for Holocaust Remembrance Day. All the scrolls come to wherever, we bring the scrolls there, and they get freighted in, and it's a very, people are just, if you imagine people wanting to touch the scroll today, those scrolls are very sacred to everybody, and they bring them in, and they sit out, and do a big program, and then they parade back out, so it's a really special way to remember, and they were witness to everything. Yes? is in our library. We took it off the wooden rollers, and it sits in a glass case. But absolutely, there are scrolls in a lot of places. In Israel, in the Israel Museum, they have the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were rolled up, and there are Torah scrolls and even more books that are in the Bible. But they're in the museum. Those are from thousands of years ago. What religion does Joseph?
Genesis?
Judaism?
Oh, like what are the other branches? Okay,
oh,
that's
okay.
A great question.
You made it.
Cool. So Judaism, so we kind of belong to a family that's called like the Abrahamic religions, right? So there's Judaism in all its facets where we happen to be Reformed here in this congregation, but there's also conservative, which follows more closely to certain traditions called halakha, the Orthodox, which are very bound to the Torah, and then there's Christianity that came out of Judaism, and then there is Islam, which you could actually argue came out of either Judaism or Christianity. I mean, they have aspects of Christianity, but they came from they're actually the father of Islam is way back was a brother of Abraham's son, so it goes pretty far back. So those are the three big religions that come out of it, and those are called like the Abrahamic religions. They all come from the father Abraham. Does that answer your question?
That answer? And then Judaism has different denominations.
Mm-hmm.
Reform, conservative, Orthodox,
constructionist.
Yeah, there's a lot of different ones.
What was the bread you were talking about?
What was the bread I ate? Great. That was challah. Just a regular egg bread. It's grated. And so we always say before we eat a blessing that just thanks God for bringing forth bread and food or sustenance from the earth. But when we say a blessing, we always have to follow of an action. We always have to follow through with it. So that's why I had a piece of bread, even though they all were going to go inside and celebrate. And when you guys are finished, we have snacks out for you. There was bread, so I ate it on behalf of everybody. It's an egg bread. We have it for all of our holidays. You can eat it anytime. It makes really good French toast.
Yeah. You can buy it at Trader Joe's. It's delicious.
You know, we always hear a lot of science, kosher food.
Yes.
So what is kosher food and what
all
is
right.
The significance of
okay, so what is kosher food? Kosher is a huge question. So starting at the basic, in the Torah, it tells us what animals we can and can't eat. So animals that chew its cud, animals that have split hooves, and birds of, you can't have birds of prey, you can't have, if you eat fish, they have to have fins and scales. And then we have a bit that tells us that you can't boil a kid in its mother's milk. And so then people will say, well, we can't mix milk and we can't mix meat. On top of what are all the animals we can and can't eat, there's also a prescribed way for how one kills the animals that they are going to eat. So we're not allowed to actually go out and hunt animals. You actually have to, if you are killing, well, the only way you can eat your meat is to kill it, you have to slice it in the jugular and you have to hang it upside down and let it drain and so on. It has to be prepared in a certain way. So when we talk about kosher foods in the store or in a restaurant, beyond all of the basic rules of what are the specified animals you can eat and can't eat, and the Torah will name things you can, and it says things you can't eat. So for instance, the one big meat that Jews don't eat is pork, and it says to us you can't eat pork. It doesn't chew its cud and have split hooves. Some animals have one or the other. You have to have both of them. So when you are buying kosher food, kosher meat means that it was slaughtered and prepared in a way that it's ritually okay for you to eat. When you're buying kosher food, so let's say like cookies, for instance. Biggest example I like to give is Oreo cookies. How many people like to eat Oreo cookies? Me too. When I was a kid, we didn't eat Oreo cookies. The reason was is that Oreo cookies, way back when, had lard in them. Had lard. Lard generally comes from pigs, and so it meant we couldn't eat those. So we ate Hydra, that's what he ate. When I think I was in high school, Oreo started to change their formula. They started with the minis, and now all of them are. They took the lard out of their cookies, and somebody came in and checked all of their ingredients, checked their machines to make sure they were contaminated with other products that were kosher. And so therefore, Oreos got to put a symbol on their package that says they're kosher. There's a lot of different symbols. Some people accept these symbols, some people don't accept other symbols. But generally what you'll see, it's a circle, like an O with a U inside. And that's generally a big sign that tells us that it's kosher. Or sometimes you might see a K inside a triangle or something like that. Another example might be, this will just, how many people like candy? So there are lots of candies that are kosher, and there are lots of candies that aren't kosher. Some candies that aren't kosher are those that are made with gelatin. Anybody know what gelatin is made from? Not from pig fat. Yeah. Not animal fat. There actually, somebody has created a formula that makes it out of some sort of vegetable, too.
Yeah, that's what jelly belly is.
Right. So there are some candies that are kosher because they're made out of non-kosher gelatin. Or, believe it or not, you know how Skittles are red and Skittles are yellow and things like that? Many of the dyes in our candies are actually made from bugs. Yep. And sometimes those bugs are not kosher bugs. There are kosher bugs in the Torah. They're made from non-kosher bugs. So therefore, because that insect is in the dye or it's made from, we can't eat it, so it's not kosher. So, and then there's just general things. So like if you're having a hamburger, we don't have a cheese on it. We don't have cheese on it because we don't mix milk and meat together.
Go farther than that. There are some people who are so observant that they don't allow themselves to have milk and meat within a 6-hour window together. I have a friend who puts a timer on her phone when she's finished eating meat so that she knows she can have dairy 6 hours later.
Because then you've gotten all the meat out of your mouth and out of your system and they're not mixing them.
Yes?
Who is Adonai?
Adonai is just a name for God. Literally, it means my sir in Hebrew, but it's a name for God.
She just applied. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Starting to.
So what does that mean? What does cantor mean, and what does she have to do to become a cantor?
Okay, so in Judaism, our spiritual leaders are rabbis. So I'm a rabbi, I studied to be a rabbi, and then cantors. Cantors, I always say the easiest is if you base it on, if you know Christianity, like a music minister in a congregation. A cantor is the person who holds the musical tradition, and we have a very large musical tradition within Judaism when it comes to chanting the Torah and knowing how to do that. There's all sorts of prayers and rituals, but a cantor really functions much in the same way as a rabbi, but part of the difference in the teachings is that where I would have spent time focused on speech writing and sermons and things like that, a cantor will focus on music and learning all the various musical traditions and so on. But in the end, we both come out and have that ability to minister and go into hospitals and do chaplaincy and do life cycle events and so on.
Do they usually have to go to a separate school, like learn for a certain number of years to take up a year?
Correct. So after regular undergraduate college, the seminary program is 5 years of graduate school. So Calix is finishing up college, and so is now applying for cantorial school, which is seminary, and so would start next summer.
Good job.
So.
What were you doing before?
Torah and Hebrew. Hebrew is in the Torah.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes.
I'll take this one. So this is actually a really interesting question because there are lots of instruments we play. We have an organ over there that's really beautiful that our friend David Cohen plays during the Friday night services. We have a piano as well. A lot of cantors tend to play guitars. I kind of fall out of the norm. I've been playing ukulele like 8 years. It's something that I love to play. But funny enough, in the halakha, which is like kind of the, like, I guess, old ordinance thing that we're told.
Jewish law.
Yeah, Jewish law.
Law.
Yeah. Essentially, we're told that we can't do any work on Shabbat. So because we're a Reform congregation, we don't adhere so specifically to that. And actually, the playing of an instrument isn't doing work, but tuning the instrument is. So a lot of congregations that are conservative Orthodox, ultra-Orthodox, they don't have instruments on Shabbat. It's done a cappella or without instruments.
So, but there can be lots of different
instruments. Yeah, I've seen rabbis play banjos. I've seen cantors play mandolins. Any instrument that you can play on the bima.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Last question, please. The Jewish star.
Jewish
symbolism star. Of Judaism in the star, you know.
Yes.
The star in the six prongs. Any significance to it?
So funny and great you should ask. So you are absolutely right. The Jewish star has been ascribed to the Jewish people as a symbol of Judaism. The 6 points and the 2 triangles put on top of each other. Does it have religious significance? No, it does not. Not like the cross has significant religious significance to Christianity. It is a symbol. Some say that it might have been the symbol on King David's shield. We don't know for sure. But over the centuries or millennia, it was a star that was ascribed to the Jewish people, and so it stuck. So religiously, no, there isn't any sort of reason that we have for it. It just is. What's actually interesting is in the Torah, the first symbol of the nation is actually a menorah, the 7-branch menorah.
We put it right up on the right here.
There, or these are modern interpretations of them, but the 7-branch ones. Many of you might know that at Hanukkah we use a 9-branch one, but the 7-branch one represents the 7 days of the week and represents creation and so on. So that was the first real symbol, but it's the star that stuck.
That is the
seven. Yes, yes, that is on both sides. These are meant to be menorahs. This window is meant to represent sort of Jewish history. From the very beginning, you have the center, that really tall center window is meant to represent the tree in the Garden of Eden. You see the serpent at the bottom. You see Adam and Eve and their sons. And when you move out, you know, there's Moses in the basket in the second window with the pyramids of Egypt. There's chains for the slavery. In this far window over here, you have a burning temple in Jerusalem. So much so that you have Noah's Ark. But if you look in this window just to the right of the tall window, what do you see at the top? What symbol do you see at the top? E=mc². Why do you think that might be there? Einstein. He was Jewish. Also, you have the atomic symbol. Whether or not we're fully proud of it, what came out of that. But nonetheless, a great scientific breakthrough. And so part of that is to recognize not only the biblical history, but even the modern history and the contributions of Jews, at least to Jewish history and to world history. So, and then these windows represent the prophets. Yes, ma'am.
What is like
the circle hat? This is a kippah or a yarmulke. It is actually not required, but something that became traditional and culturally accepted. It's really, some people wear it all the time. And some people, I just wear it when I lead a service, and it's meant as a reminder that there's something above, something bigger, that God is present. Yes, sir. Forgot, I'm now coming back to you. actually Jews pray three times a day, and so some congregations will have services every morning and every evening, and many times, let's say people are working, sometimes if there's a lot of Jews working in one place, let's say downtown, there might be a space where they might gather together midday and do their prayers together, or they just do them by themselves. A hair clip. A lot of people use bobby pins, so we use different things. That's how it stays. Or some people who don't have any hair at all, it just balances.
I know someone who has very short hair that uses Velcro.
Yes, sometimes people will use Velcro. Yes. So Judaism began with Abraham, which was Abraham being called by God, which happened in like Iraq. And then he moved and came to Israel. And then later, his grandson Jacob and his great-grandson Joseph was sold into slavery and ended up in Egypt. And then later on, everybody moved down to Egypt. They were in Egypt for 400 years. And enslaved for a good portion of that. So they were there as a community, but then when they came out of Egypt, then they went back into the land of Israel. So there are actually a lot of similarities. When you read through the Quran, there are some very similar stories, where in the Torah, some of those things were between Abraham and Isaac. In the Quran, they're between Abraham and Ishmael, Abraham's other son. But there are a lot of similarities, and actually, there are a lot of similarities between Arabic and Hebrew in a lot of the practice. But so, for instance, one of the things that I have learned is that our burial practices and our rituals surrounding death are very similar in Islam and in Judaism. So there are lots of things when we stop and we learn about each other, we look and say, wow, we look really similar in some of these practices. Exactly, follow kosher. So, exactly. And so it's actually interesting. Judaism, so kosher, kashrut, is actually more strict than halal. However, in Islam, I know many Muslims who, if they can't find halal meat, they can eat kosher meat. Yeah. It doesn't flip the other way. Judaism is very strict about what it has to be, but it's a very, I've known many Muslims who have lived in towns where they couldn't get halal meat, but they were very thankful to be able to go to the kosher butcher or go to the market and be able to find kosher meat. Yeah. Prophets. So there's the books of the prophets in the Bible. And so prophets were people who heard God and had to share God's message with all the people. And so those windows represent the different books of the prophets. There are many more prophets than seven, but they represent the idea of the prophets and the stories and what they taught.
Does a religion believe in rebirth? Rebirth.
Reincarnation. So, death and dying and afterlife in Judaism is very interesting. So let me first say that there are lots of different ideas in Judaism, and there actually is no definitive answer. And part of that is one of our greatest scholars once said, nobody has died and come back to tell us what there is. So we shouldn't spend all of our time focused on whatever's coming next. That being said, there are some scholars, some rabbis in Judaism who have discussed the idea of rebirth, that our souls, that there's a set number of souls that exist in the world, and that souls are born, and after they finish their life, they can be reborn in another person, as perhaps a different person, but it's that same soul. Some people believe that there are so many souls, they don't need to be reborn, and so that when a soul spends its time, has its life, then it goes to the world to come afterwards, and some describe that as a place like paradise. It's a return to God. It's a return to all of the wonderful things that could be, its perfection. And so all the souls go there, and they sit, and they're with God, and are doing incredibly wonderful things for the rest of time. So some believe, yes, they can be reborn and reused again, and some people say, there's so many, they don't have to be reused again.
So, is being a rabbi and a cantor, is that your day job, or do you guys do something else, and this is something, you know, that is it a way of, you know, giving back to somebody? How does that?
So it is 100% a day job and more. So it is 24/7. You are always on call. So besides leading services, you basically minister and pastor to the congregation. So I can be called for anything. If somebody just needs to talk, if I need to go visit somebody in the hospital, if somebody has passed away, doing a funeral, doing weddings, working, teaching in the congregation, and so on. So it's a profession.
It's a profession. And another question. I have two more.
Yeah.
So you said that in Judaism, like, certain, you know, work or jobs can be done by men, certain things by women. So is being, you know, can women be a rabbi and a cantor, or is it something that is very specific to this synagogue?
So, great question. So traditionally, being a cantor and a rabbi were for men. It's believed that throughout the ages, there probably were women who were pushing that envelope, whose fathers taught them. There was a long-held belief that women didn't need to study Torah or study Talmud or study all the great writings that were out there. But there were some families who very much believed that girls should be educated just as much as boys. So it isn't clear if there were females who were serving in some of these roles. In modern times, they believe that there may have been a woman who was ordained in the Reformed Jewish tradition in the 1930s in Germany, but she perished in World War II in one of the camps. If we go even, you know, more modern from that, the first female rabbi was ordained in the United States in the Reform Movement in 1972. Conservative Judaism ordained in 1986, I believe. And actually, some groups of Orthodox began ordaining women, I think it was 2009, 2010. They don't, so in a Reform congregation, in this congregation, I won't say that all Reformed congregations necessarily agree or buy into having a female as a leader, either as a cantor or a rabbi, but for those that do in Reformed Judaism, males and females as cantors and rabbis are completely equal. We can do the same things. Pretty much so in Conservative Judaism as well. In Orthodox, that's not the case. There is still a belief that there are certain roles for men, there are certain roles for women, but it's a recognition now that women can minister to other women and can teach them and can be spiritual leaders. And so women are, in some groups of Orthodox, being trained and ordained to serve as rabbis. They get called by a different name, but they are serving in that function.
Okay. I have one last question for the day. So when I saw the congregation this morning, most of them were of about a certain age.
Yes.
So do you have separate congregation time for separate age groups, and, you know, to cater to that age group, or why is...
No. This particular morning, so I would say during the summertime, especially especially in July, we often do not have Saturday morning services. You guys actually came on a day where we're having them, and that's because in July, we always have one Saturday morning where we specifically honor our congregants who are 70 and above. So they come, they like to pray together. Sometimes we do a little more English than we might normally do because that's what they grew up with. So that's why today you saw a congregation that was much older. Friday nights, which is when we have our really big services, it's very mixed. Yeah, we try not to separate. The tapestry with the tree. So what it says in the and the idea is that the Torah is a tree of life. And so
that's just a tapestry. Those are meant to be,
the curtain is meant to be roots that are coming down. Yes? So sometimes they do. Sometimes I have to go really far away not to get a phone call to come back. But usually there are people who can help out when I go on vacation. But I find that sometimes I have to actually leave the United States to not get a vote. For example, our cantor's on sabbatical, which is why I'm here, actually.
Yes.
So he's on an extended break, and so that's why Calix is helping.
Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God?
So we believe that Jesus is the Son of God, just like any of us are the children of God. So we don't believe that Jesus was divine or imbued with any divine spirit any more than a normal human being. And so in that case, probably the next answer would be is that we don't see in Judaism that Jesus fulfilled what the expectations were to be a Messiah. So we don't see Jesus in that. And actually, according to Judaism, the Messiah is not divine. The Messiah is a person like any of us. Messiah or Mashiach means somebody who's anointed. So it'd be a person who is chosen by God to be that leader of the people to bring about a time of peace. So we often talk about in Judaism that we don't know who the Messiah is going to be. And so we should treat the person who is sitting next to us as if that person could find out and rise up one day that he or she is the Messiah. So we always need to think about how we treat other people.
So is one Jew by birth, or you know, one can follow?
Both. Okay. You can be a Jew by birth, or you can choose to convert to Judaism. So you would study, and then you would proclaim yourself Jewish, and there are differing ways for men. You have to be circumcised or have a special ritual and go to the mikvah, which is a ritual bath. And for women, you go to the mikvah, the ritual bath.
Some congregations don't allow the conversion, right? In New York, especially, I heard that it's impossible to get converted, non-Jewish to become Jewish. In some places. I understand there are different.
It depends on the congregation, but actually, so. Sometimes it depends on the congregation, but I would say it's never impossible. The issue really is that in Judaism, we don't proselytize. We don't seek converts. Thousands of years ago, we did, but due to safety, we don't go out and put ourselves out there and say, hey, come join us. However, if somebody were to come in and say, hey, I really want to study and I think I might want to be Jewish, there might be some roadblocks put in your way, but part of that is to make sure that you're actually determined to truly want to become Jewish and to recognize, and one of the things that we often say is a reminder to people that not only are you accepting the faith, but you accept what comes along with it. So that recognition is that you may love being Jewish, but you also have to accept that there are a lot of people out there who don't like Jews. And you then become part of this people that isn't always appreciated by other people. And so it's a making sure that somebody recognizes you get to take the good with the not so good if you're coming in. So it might seem like it's hard and difficult, but people are, even in the most traditional of congregations, as long as you are coming in and you really want to follow the rules and take them on and learn, it's always open.
So if I become Jewish, my kids automatically and my wife automatically become Jewish, or they are also able to?
So if you and your wife were to become Jewish and your kids are already born, then your kids would have to convert. If you and your wife become Jewish and you're before your children are born, your children are, when they're born, they're automatically Jewish because the parents are already Jewish.
So when you remember God, what is God to you? Christianity, when you say God, is it the same thing? When the book here says God, my God, so what is it? Are you referring to a person or is it a divine thing that nobody has seen?
Yeah. It could be all of those. It depends on who you're talking to who's sitting out there. But generally, I would say God is a divine thing, being whatever that is part of the natural order of this world, that in whatever way I choose to believe or you may choose to believe is interacting or not interacting, but over this world in that spiritual way, supernatural, whatever. Does that answer it?
Yeah.
Okay, just to summarize, what would be in Judaism 5 do's and 5 don'ts that you would prescribe to be a person of following Judaism?
That's a great question. That is a great question. My answers might be very different than Calix's answers, but they may be very different than the Orthodox rabbi's answers.
Okay.
The don'ts might be easier.
Yeah.
So I'll start with the don'ts. So for us, the don'ts would be, actually they might be similar to the do's. Start with the do's. Believe in one God, but there's only one God. What else would I say are do's?
Kindness and compassion.
I was gonna say kind of loving your neighbor, as the idea you love your neighbor as you love yourself. We're always working towards the betterment of the world. Right, so it's not just about us. It's about being partners with God in building a perfect world.
Respect for people outside of the religion and not forcing them to be one way or another, really, in the modern age.
Great. I would say a respect for... I don't know that in Judaism, we don't necessarily have a set creed or set belief that you have to believe, but learning is a major, you cannot make a decision that you don't believe or you're not going to do without understanding what is and why. So I would say learning and always studying and challenging yourself. Yisrael is one that struggles with God, and so that's at a core foundation of Judaism, that we struggle with God, with whatever that is, and we struggle. We don't have to have absolute perfect belief or faith all the time. We're open to doubt. We can always ask those questions. Questioning is rather encouraged, actually. So the don'ts.
We'll do this together.
Yeah. Unnecessary cruelty or murder or anything like that, I think, is number one. I would say if we're looking at it in the context of other faith traditions, when we talk about belief that God is one, there is no belief in other gods. Which, when we look at Christianity and the way that Jesus is looked at in a godlike manner, and one cannot believe that Jesus is the Messiah and that Jesus is the divine Son of God and also be Jewish. The two faith theological traditions don't match at all. So that would be one when we think about the context of Christianity or living in a more Christian world. Other don'ts.
Don't be stubborn in your ways. Be willing to learn.
Okay, be willing to learn.
Wouldn't you go through the Ten Commandments?
So we have 613 commandments.
Yeah, I know.
Yes, we have 10. The 10 are commandments.
Right. The Torah.
But the in Judaism, the Torah has 613. Yeah. And the belief is that there isn't a hierarchy of them, that they all are pretty much equal, and we should all strive to do them. However, a good half of them no Jewish person can do because they are laws of sacrifice. When the temple was destroyed in 70, not 1970, but in 70 of the Common Era, Jews stopped sacrificing animals. So we have not done that, and so there's lots of do nots. There's lots of sacrificial laws that we can't do. There are also a lot of agricultural laws or agrarian laws, and because most of us aren't farmers anymore, or we might not be living in the land of Israel, and so some of those laws are pertain to the land of Israel, we can't do those. But certainly, we're supposed to strive to do those, as many as we can.
Thank you.
Corey, this is our last one. Okay. I didn't know if they had the stuff set up too. Great. So it's called a ner tamid, which is an eternal light, an eternal flame. And in the Torah, so when I talked about those menorahs that are there, in the tent of meeting where God was present, or later when the temple was built in Jerusalem, lights were used to show that God was present. The priests would light the menorahs and they'd stay lit, and they'd show that God was present. So when that temple was destroyed, and when Jews built synagogues around the world, they always contained an eternal light, a light that was always lit to show that God was present in this place. So once upon a time, you are absolutely correct, it was fire. They often were oil lamps. And it was someone's job to always go and make sure there was always oil and a wick, so that it never went out. When electricity came about and when it was very regular, it actually became dangerous for us to have an open flame all the time. So we moved to electric lights. Now, that light is on its completely own circuit. So when we turn every light off in the building, that light is still on. The only time that light goes out is when we lose power. When the power gets shut down, because we don't have, I mean, I guess we could have a generator on it if we wanted to, but it's connected to its own circuit, so the only time it goes out is when the power goes out. And or I guess if the light bulb went out, it's someone's job to make sure that they're paying attention to how old the bulb is and change it.
But that doesn't mean there's not flames in other congregations.
Correct.
I actually belong to a different congregation. I belong to Sharon, that's over at Purdue and New Ballast, and we have a flame that is powered by natural gas.
Oh.
And in the synagogue, I don't know if it's on right now because I'm doing construction, but it was always on. And I've never seen it lose anything, even when there were problems in construction on the road. It has its own supply. So there are some places with very controlled, like the natural gas like comes from a pipeline, and there's a certain amount that is going through. It's way more controlled than just a plain old oil lamp.
Well, thank you guys so much.
Thank you very much for your time and patience and answering all the 100 questions.
Absolutely.
I've been counting those 100.
Anytime. You are always welcome.
I'll take it over 24 hours.
Thank you.